other big thing is when you start learning how to use this, learning how to use Linux, which is very, 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 very pervasive. It's a skill that's extremely,
PENGUICON 2015.
So I don't think you'd be wasting your time using Linux. You could use that on many, many, many other platforms moving forward. So I think it's a pretty useful skill set. So you're not really wasting your time, in my opinion. It's available for around $50. It ranges anywhere from about $40 to $60, depending on if you're buying it from, you know, deals at Micro Center or online at Amazon, kind of on the more expensive end. If it's costing you more than that, you're definitely paying too much. We have two manufacturers of the board. Let me turn off my ESPN alerts. We have two manufacturers of the board. One is in Richardson, Texas. It's named Circuitco Electronics. The other one is Element 14. So sadly, or whatever to say, these are all made in China. We simply just weren't able to get enough manufacturing with the team in Texas. They're both the same price. We just didn't get enough volume just from those guys. But it's the same design, just assembled in a different place. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on specs. I will spend some time, and Justin's brought some demos in of things that he's created. And I'll pause you all again once we kind of get to a reasonable stopping point to driver installs and get him to show off some of the things that he's created. But there's just a huge, huge number of things that you can create, and lots of really, there's really fantastic community around it. We meet up at I3 Detroit, which is a fantastic hackerspace in Ferndale. We meet up there every month. So it's a nice place to kind of hang out and chat with other people trying to learn how to use the BeagleBone at really various skill levels, right? People just starting to learn how to program in electronics, all the way up to you know, people doing very sophisticated project hacks. And there's I'll give you another URL. It's bit.ly. / Beagle Meetup, and that'll take you to information about the monthly meetups at I3 Detroit. All right, now just a little bit more about the development model, so that you guys that are sitting around with the boards plugged into your laptops, and last chance, is there anybody that needs a board to set up here? All right. I do want these back, unless you want to pay for it. Pass that one down.
How much is it?
It's $50 for me. So yes, please, if you're gonna walk out of the room, please come by and pay me $50. You don't have a laptop, so you're not gonna be using it in here, so you're planning on buying. Oh, okay, great.
One more?
Perfect.
You got one more?
Yep.
Can I pull this chair up?
Right. Super last call anymore. All right.
I'm good.
What? Did I hear one more? Okay. Super. Yeah. Done with last call. So the basic principle operation, when you buy a BeagleBone Black, you're just getting the Linux computer board and a USB cable, and that's it. Right. That's all that ships in the box. But the board has onboard flash. It has 4 gigabytes of flash on it. It's programmed with Debian Wheezy, right? So that's Debian 7. So, yay Debian!
Yay!
Debian! I'm super excited.
But we do add a few extra things on here to like the base Debian install. They're in our repos, or Robert Nelson's repos. Robert Nelson is the guy that maintains the Linux kernel. As part of the community, and also maintain some of the package feeds. So we ship with Debian Wheezy. We pull from the main repo. So if it's in Debian Wheezy for ARMHF, you can just apt-get install it, and it works. There are Jesse images. There's pretty much every Linux distribution available for it, and lots of non-Linux distributions and stuff available for it as well. But you know, when you plug it in, we have the Linux kernel configured to act as a flash drive, a network device, and a serial interface. So the flash drive is just like what you normally see files on. The reason we do that is because we ship with drivers for Mac and Windows for the network interface, which is not by default, whereas the Flash interface, pretty much everybody has that. Right, so if you look at any computer in the world, it's going to support the Flash drive interface. Those drivers, currently on these boards, is shipping the old April 23 image from 2014. We really need to get these guys to update the image that ships on the boards. If you go to beagleBone.org/getting-started, there's a newer set of drivers that are signed. If you want to do a Windows 8 or you want to do the Mac, not Mountain Lion, not Yosemite. Yeah, that's the one. Yosemite. Then you need to go to the beagleBone.org/getting-started in order to get the drivers for Yosemite. Otherwise, if we're running an old system, you don't have to be on the internet. You just plug it in, it's a flash drive. You go and look on the flash drive for a file called start.htm, and that will pretty much walk you through the entire installation process and give you a whole bunch of background information. I don't think it's too much to sit there and read it all. Most people just don't. Most of the time, their questions would be answered if they just read it. I know if more people read it, I would get more bug reports on it and people telling me all the things that are wrong with it. They're pretty minor, but I know that nobody reads it because they're there.
The cool thing about the documentation is that it's interactive. There's like code blocks in it that you can run and you can edit, and like it will run on your board in that start file. Like,
yeah.
You can load up interactive documentation.
And so, like, one of them, like, so when you, the step three is essentially pointing your web browser to the web server that's running off the BeagleBone. So that's another one of these kind of default services. How many of you have heard Node.js? Node.js? Yeah, you know, maybe a third or a half. That's pretty good. It's a JavaScript interpreter that's been used to run a lot of web servers on the internet, and it's running the web server, it's on port 80. So if you're looking for Apache, where the hell is my Apache? It's on port 8080. That's where it's configured. So Apache is already there, but we just moved the port because we've got the Node stuff running on port 80. The Node stuff running on port 80 is running Socket.io, which is a JavaScript library that allows you to create bidirectional communications. And that's what allows that applications running in the browser to talk to applications running on the BeagleBone. And bi-directional, so it can actually get events from the board back into the browser. Question?
I know you said that there's Apache already running on there. Can you switch that up to Nginx, which I
don't know if you want to do? Yeah, if you want to do Nginx, it's Debian.
Okay, so it's not going to cause, like, yes.
Yeah, if you want to run Nginx, if you want to do, I don't know, what? If you want Ruby, Ruby on Rails, you want to do whatever, it's, you know, it's Debian. You just do it. There is this other thing. So is anybody, as everybody who is sitting down and installing drivers, I should take a kind of a quick run around. How many of you have made it to that first interactive page, the one that's being served up off of it? So not so many. I mean, people are still just got a base installing the drivers.
All right.
So the principle of operations, we try to ship with documentation. That all that documentation that's shipping on the board is on a website called GitHub. How many of you have heard of GitHub? Oh, thank you. Oh, that makes me happy. So those of you that haven't, it's the best thing since sliced bread. And it's Git itself is one of these wonderful things that happen when you piss off Linus Torvalds. And he goes off and writes the best version control management software known to man. GitHub is a really fantastic website that maintains that. So basically, they pretty well dominate. And unfortunately, they're open source, but they pretty much dominate the world of open source software in terms of hosting. And it's a really great place to explore code, and there's a lot of Beagle-related code up on GitHub. You know, there you Node and Python and all sorts of things. But we maintain the source for BeagleBone.org's website and all the website documentation that ships on the board on github.com/BeagleBone. So if you look at the Bone 101 repository, That's the stuff that ships on the board. Again, what's shipping on these is what's April of last year. It's gone through some improvements since then. All right, so the principle is that you have all the basic documentation you need to get started right there on you. So I think on the board, so I think a lot of you are probably lost in reading the documentation and playing with it. But another big part of the experience, in addition to what Justin was talking about, that interactive web page, where you can actually have JavaScript running in the browser and it teaches you a bunch of JavaScript commands and sends them down to the board. There's also this IDE, or Integrated Development Environment. And that's running on port 3000. Some of you might not have found what is the magic IP address. Okay, who knows what the magic IP address is for the BeagleBone? How did you find it?
Star.htm, will actually
it tells
the IP of anything?
No, it knows. So let me back up just real quick. So to explain what's happening, so this looks like a network adapter to your computer, and then it has a virtual network adapter of its own. When you plug a new network adapter into your computer, and it's on a network, it's going to say, hey, I need an IP address. And it's going to go ask the network for an IP address. And the BeagleBone is going to answer. And it's always going to give it the same address. It's always going to give your computer the address 192.168.7.1.
7.2
is the BeagleBone. So it's always giving your computer 192.168.7.1 and holding on to it for itself, 192.168.7.2. Question.
Is it a /24?
It is a /30.
Oh,
it's /30.
Okay.
So it's because all the only two things that are ever going to exist on it, and then you have .3 essentially for broadcast, right?
Right. Yeah.
So 1.1, .2, and .3, and then .0.
So BeagleBone is running its own DHCP server.
It is. It is running its own DHCP server. It does not, as part of that, provide any DNS though. What it does do, however, is provide multicast DNS. So if it's plugged into a LAN, it's actually going to be broadcasting itself as BeagleBone.local. So you can just take this port at home, plug it under Ethernet, apply a power, and open your browser to BeagleBone.local. As long as you're in the same subnet, it will just find it. Oh, except if you're using Windows, because Windows sucks.
Hey, now. I like
Windows.
Windows is good for gaming.
So if you're running Windows, then you got to go log into your router and find out where is the BeagleBone on your network and get its IP address. But Mac and Linux PCs are smart enough to figure out multicast DNS. All right, so that explains what the magic IP, like 192.168.7.2. And you browse to that. If you've got the drivers installed, you're now into this built-in tutorial. So the next step is, like, you'll see one of these things called Cloud9 IDE is one of the options. And that's essentially just the board, but it's running at port 3000. So if you click on the thing, it takes you kind of to a description because it's trying to communicate all these things to you. I just want you to jump into it without kind of seeing a little bit of an overview. Forget it, just click on the picture and you'll get into the IDE. So I saw him do it. So if you click on the picture, backing up yet again. Don't use Internet Explorer.
But even then,
did you really have to tell us that?
I don't think so. But there was a little warning in the documentation here that says don't use Internet Explorer. Chrome and Firefox work nicely. I have seen bugs in some of the development versions of Chrome. The latest for development versions of Chrome.
Older versions of Firefox, like Socket.io.
And really old versions of Firefox. You want a recent Firefox, or a recent Chrome, but not virtually any Chrome except for the bleeding edge ones. There's some bugs in them.
Not the nightlies.
Not the nightlies. And I've been running the development tips because I needed some USB access. Anyway.
USB access.
USB access. Yeah, because I was trying to reprogram the flash on the board from the browser. And honestly, I hit reload. I don't know what's taking so long. Let's go. It does take a minute to load. Hello.
It's probably balanced.
All right. So.
Correct me on the go to something .2.
Yep.
And it's basically just stuck.
So did you finish the installation of the drivers?
Well, the only thing I did was install them.
Oh,
you
don't
need
to do.
Does anybody got
a
drivers?
I really
didn't
run
you
down.
Well,
I just think it's that. Which is why I've got files.
Okay, but do you have the list your IO config and see what your ports? You should have an abort that show that.
Oh, that's wrong then. That should be 200.
If you don't have it all set up,
you should have 5 times a second.
So
maybe
you need a DH client on that.
Yeah, we can't find any erasers. I found them.
So reading about Sakado, you're in the IDE.
Yep, I'm
still.
Awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to work on this. So.
So still installing drivers in the IDE. So you're still trying to get communications going.
I'm still waiting for.
What are you installing?
Chrome is still in Chrome.
Firefox? Firefox in the app.
What version of the
But do you know that did you get the drivers installed okay? Did the start go double check mark?
It's connected to it. On the right idea, actually, in the browser, that should be enough.
Yeah. We connected it when it comes to
Oh, we did get a connection?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's just the
JavaScript wasn't. You're in the IDE.
I'm in.
And you saw the LEDs. And that's actually running directly in the browser. You can edit that code and change the behavior.
Once they have control on
Look at your network adapters.
You
did install the drivers and network adapters. I'm going to try to get everybody's attention one more time because a lot of people are very intimidated by the Linux command line. And my hope is that the BeagleBone Black is actually an opportunity for you to end that fear. Because this thing is $50. The worst case is you go buy another one. That's not likely. You can't break it by with software. You can always reflash this board and get it back to some good configuration. You may need to download an SD card image and actually boot off the SD card image in order to do that, but you can always get back there. Don't worry, you're not going to break it in software. So please hack. You mess it up, just reflash it, restore it back to the latest image, and you'll be great. So please don't be hesitant to type in things. You know, maybe one day you want to try out rm-rf /.
Just to see what it does.
Make
sure you have a computer with an internet connection.
You will be
able to talk to you about it.
Have to actually do --no-preserve-root.
I disagree. I think the Linux command line is extremely sexy.
Yeah.
No, it's a scary.
It's a scary.
It's scary.
Oh,
it is.
It's scary.
It's
scary.
What
really sexy isn't scary?
Bash is sexy.
That's for later.
Oh, I'm going to say that now on. That's
so,
awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I will say if you do go back to the page that had that big, that first 192.168.7.2 document, and that big long line of stuff, if you scroll down and you read all that text, there's a section in there that's listing off a bunch of Linux commands. Right? So, like, you're wondering, what the heck do I try here? And there's a whole bunch of them to try. The most important one to learn is man. And I'm getting all sorts of inappropriate
things.
It's very much worth trying. And this, I think, is actually pretty revolutionary with the BeagleBone, the idea that in your web browser, you're now learning from the Linux command line.
Oh,
Thank you.
So yeah, you're running
These are all shipping with
running open source. Running open source.
Okay. Yeah, it doesn't have the same drivers.
It's the network device. It doesn't show up.
Right.
And what kind of network device is it for?
It's the R Incos.
Yeah.
It's not true. So, go on software.openstreetmap.org.
Really? It's not in the kernel? It's a kernel thing. It's like an ACM.
But it may be a KMP.
Susie was semi-retarded about certain milliseconds.
Yeah. So, is it there? Is like an Othello? Like, can you do mod pro?
Yeah, you could do a mod pro, but it should have already probed it if it was.
Well, I have to know
what should
have
been. What's D message tail? What's D message tail? D message private tail? You can put
your map. I disagree. Have you guys ever had the luck?
Tail is the last command.
Okay, well, questions? Just let me know.
Absolutely. If you have a computer that has SSH and you get the network connection, you don't need to use any of this one, the browser-based stuff. You can simply SSH into it.
Oh,
so
why
not?
It runs that script.
It has SSH installed.
Sometimes I have like free BeagleBone.
BeagleBone, and that's how I identify which one is. Oh, so you guys are just like, turn on the lights, so I know which one I'm talking to.
If you had a suitcase underneath the table, there are some boards in there, and some cards.
That's not so great on Windows.
You connected one to CPA, you guys need to fix.
But the default username and password root user has no password. This is as possibly insecure as could ever be. Root password is
life.
And that web browser thing at port 3000, it logs you right in as root. The idea is to make it easy to hack, not necessarily easy to object. Obviously, if you want it really secure, you probably should run a different distro than the one that ships with it. You can run it with a bunch of snappy apps. Or you can put it behind a secure firewall. Right? And of course, nobody's getting into it all through USB. This is for hacking and learning. And then once you like actually make something, then you need to start learning about what you need to do from security.
That's
right?
Why
you're building that understanding ground up. There's not much point in doing partial security. We could do some simple things, but what we really want you to do is be able to hack. There is also a Debian user. Once you bring up the GUI, it'll like if you plug in an HDMI monitor, keyboard, and mouse, it does have a full desktop on it. It's LXDE. If you use the Jesse images, it's LXQT. But it's a nice GUI desktop with everything that you're used to in GUI desktops. And there you would log in with the password TEMPPWD. So that's the password for the Debian user. It's just temp password. I'd like for now what the heck are you gonna make with these things? Right? So why on earth am I learning about this new in the first place? I'd like Justin. Can you show off some of the stuff that you've actually made with the BeagleBone Black since you bought some demos?
Yeah, a nearly finished project. I have some radio here on the table. I know these guys don't get the glorious view, but there's a USB battery pack in there and a USB speaker box, kind of like the Bluetooth ones, but it also has an auxiliary in. And I've got a BeagleBone, and there's like an audio cape you can get, because it doesn't have analog audio. I don't know if you noticed that. You can get audio over HDMI, but I wanted just analog audio. And so I connected that to the speaker, and then used the GPIO through the cape to interact with that switch on the front. There's like a rotary switch, and you can select different positions. And then the button on the top you can press, and then it will play different audio tracks depending on the position. And so that's like the radio from the Brave Little Toaster. It was actually a costume piece.
Does the default kernel image support USB DAX?
Yes, it does. Yeah, absolutely. And so that's another good way around that. I've used a couple. You get the really dirt cheap ones.
$3 on eBay from Shenzhen.
Man, like not only do they not sound as great as they could, but sometimes they will have like bad solder connections. Like maybe spend $10 and get like something that's somewhat decent. If you want to get audio out of USB. But yeah, actually, if someone hits that purple button, it should just like...
Oh, were you a nice dress? Yeah, well, I'm you, of course,
But yeah, so that's one cool thing that I've got. I've got some other toys, if anybody wants to like play with other accessories. But
If you've heard of Arduino, you've probably heard of Shields, which are add-on boards for Arduino. It seems to be the thing that all these little development boards have their own name for what is a daughter board. Our name for a daughter board is a cape. Underdog was a beagle. Underdog wore a cape. And if you put a daughter board on the BeagleBone Black, it most likely is going to have a little bit of a notch out for the head or the Ethernet jack. And so you'll have a little cutout and it'll end up looking like a cape. So that's where the name comes from. And so there's about 100 different capes you can buy, everything from building 3D printers to quadcopters to displays to wireless communications, GPS tracking devices, 3G, 4G modems, FPGAs, yes. FPGA boards.
Are capes stackable?
Capes are stackable up to 4. So we have an identification scheme where you put EEPROMs on there. But we don't have a great way to handle the fact that you could put your EEPROM with the same address. So we don't have like a wiring scheme that solves that. Instead, a lot of them have dip switches. So you, if you want to not have conflicts on the stacked capes, you flip the dip switch. That also doesn't resolve the fact that some capes may choose to use the same pin. So you have to actually examine the pins that are being used by the cape. And not you can make sure if you add another cape that it's not using the same pins. Or if it does, there's something like I2C, which is busable. So you can actually have multiple capes using the I2C pins.